Hi guys, welcome back. This is Dr. Hadi here. Today's topic is from the biochemistry, that is irreversible enzyme inhibition. The topic which we started earlier was enzyme inhibition. Inside this topic, enzyme inhibition, we discussed reversible enzyme inhibition in detail. Today, we will discuss irreversible enzyme inhibition. In this topic, we will provide you some definition, example of irreversible enzyme inhibition, and the clinical importance. Why this topic is important? How to apply this topic in clinical life? Means how to treat alcohol addicts, those person who are alcohol addicts and they want to get rid of alcohol. So how to treat them? This is also included in today's lecture. So let's start. The irreversible enzyme inhibition. Here we have an enzyme, just like in the previous lecture. And this time we have inhibitor here. This is our inhibitor. This is our inhibitor. What happened? That this time the inhibitor makes a bond, but this time the bond is very strong. The bond is very strong. And this bond is called covalent bond. It is called as covalent bond. Once the inhibitor is attached with this enzyme will be permanently deactivated. You can also say that the enzyme is poisoned. The enzyme has been poisoned. You can also use the word poisoned because this bond is very difficult. You cannot break this bond again. You cannot make the process reversible. Okay, now we will come to the examples. There are some six examples of irreversible enzyme inhibition. The first three are very much important. The first one is iodoacetate. Here, the structure of iodoacetate, here we have acetate ion, CH2, C double bond O minus, this is acetate ion, and here iodine atom is there. This acetate ion is an irreversible inhibitor. It makes bond with enzyme, those enzyme which contain SH group. You know, enzyme are made of amino acids, the active sites, whether it is the bulk or the active site. These circles represent amino acids. So one or two amino acid having the SH group, you know, there are some amino acids which contain SH sulfhydryl group. So those amino acids at the active site which contain the SH group, this SH group will make a covalent bond with iodoacetate. So this is a covalent bond. In this case, we can say that this enzyme has been blocked irreversibly because the bond is now covalent. You know, this is inhibitor, okay? And the enzyme will be papain. This one, papain is an enzyme, and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, which we write G3P, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. You might have heard this word in glycolysis, in the metabolism of carbohydrate, in the metabolism of glucose. So if you irreversibly stop this enzyme, you can say that you can stop the metabolic process inside the human body. The second example is diisopropyl fluorophosphate. This is also called as nerve gas. It is more special than this one. It is also called as the nerve gas. Nerve gas. It was used in the Second World War. In the Second World War, and this nerve gas has resulted, the use of this nerve gas has resulted in a death of a lot of people. Lot of people. Okay. What it does, it blocks the respiratory system. It paralyzes the respiratory system of the body. How irreversibly? block acetylcholinesterase. Acetylcholinesterase is an enzyme. This is an enzyme that has a lot of function in our body. The most important function is that it breaks down acetylcholine. Acetylcholine, in shortcut we write it ACH, acetylcholine. You know, it is a neurotransmitter. Here, I have mentioned it is a neurotransmitter. This acetylcholine, once it is used, it is broken down by the help of acetylcholinesterase enzyme into choline and acetyl group. Normally, it happens. But this diisopropyl fluorophosphate, which we call as a nerve gas, the nerve gas will block this enzyme esterase. Of course, this enzyme must have some groups by the help of which the nerve gas bind, by the help of which the nerve gas make a covalent bond. So it must have. So in book it is mentioned that this enzyme contain serine amino acid. So those enzyme which contain serine amino acids can be easily blocked by this nerve gas. Which contains serine amino acid. So this is a condition that must be there. Okay, fine. Now you think, if you block this enzyme, the acetylcholine will not be broken down. As a result, we will be having a lot of acetylcholine, more acetylcholine inside your body tissues. Acetylcholine is inside your body tissues. It is in the nerve, in the neuron, in the gap. Synaptic gap, synaptic cleft, even it is present in the RBCs, fine. Even it is present, this enzyme is also present in the plasma, fine. So wherever you block this enzyme, the result will be a lot of acetylcholine accumulation. More accumulation of acetylcholine will cause toxicity. Because inside your body there was a control system. The control system was that the acetylcholine was not let to be accumulated. Instead, acetylcholine was degraded normally. But blocking this enzyme result in the accumulation of the large amount of acetylcholine, and this caused toxicity inside the body. This toxicity will be called as a nerve gas poisoning. And this can cause death. The symptoms are paralysis of the respiratory system. I mean, the person cannot breathe properly. He will be having a tight chest, difficulty in breathing, muscle twitching will be there, along with some abdominal problems, including nausea and vomiting. These all cause this problem. Okay, the third example is a disulfiram. It is more important than these two. Disulfiram is another irreversible inhibitor. It inhibits the enzyme aldehyde dehydrogenase or acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. This disulfiram is used in the treatment of alcohol addicts. I mean, those persons who are alcoholic addicts and he or she want to get rid of the alcohol. The treatment is that to provide him or her the disulfiram. How the disulfiram act? This is a person who is alcoholic. Inside the body of that person, the alcohol has to pass through this pathway. Normally, in the absence of disulfiram, when he drinks alcohol, then inside his body, the enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase will act on that alcohol and convert it into acetaldehyde. Normally, this acetaldehyde will be converted into acetic acid by the help of another enzyme, acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. So we have two enzymes that work in the metabolism of the alcohol, in the processing of the alcohol, two enzymes, two steps. The end product is acetic acid. Alcohol finally converted into acetic acid. Okay, now we want that person to stop alcohol, we will provide that person disulfiram. What disulfiram does, here I would like to write, here we have disulfiram. Okay, disulfiram does not block this amino acid, but it blocks this enzyme, which is called as acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. When this acetaldehyde dehydrogenase enzyme is blocked, the acetic acid will not be formed. The acetaldehyde will not be degraded. Acetaldehyde will not be broken down. As a result, acetaldehyde will accumulate in his or her body. Large amount of acetaldehyde in the body will produce some bad symptoms in the body of that alcoholic addicts. That is, the person suffers vomiting because large amount of acetaldehyde in the body stimulate vomiting center inside the brain. So as a result, the person will desire to vomit again and again. Vomiting is not a good condition. No one likes vomiting. As a result, he start feeling bad against alcohol because whenever he take alcohol, acetaldehyde gets accumulated in his or her body, and as a result of this acetaldehyde, vomiting start. So as long as he or she is drinking alcohol, he or she will suffer vomiting. So no one likes vomiting. As a result of this vomiting, a kind of hate is developed in the body that alcohol is very bad thing. So hopefully in this way, he or she just reject alcohol, stop taking alcohol because of this vomiting. Fine. Now the fourth, fifth and sixth examples are very simple. That is penicillin. Penicillin is a well-known antibiotics. It is a well-known antibiotics. Antibiotic. This penicillin blocks those enzymes which are involved in the synthesis of cell wall of the bacteria. Enzymes involved in the synthesis of cell wall of the bacteria. If bacterial cell wall synthesis is stopped, of course, definitely, bacterial cell will not divide. And if the bacterial cell is not divided, infection will not proceed. So in this way, we can treat a lot of infection by giving penicillin. So penicillin is also a very good example of enzyme inhibitor. The fifth and sixth are actually the inhibitor of metabolism. You know, there are some chemicals which we use as insecticides. We use on insects in order to kill them. These chemical substances, this insecticide, actually they contain enzyme inhibitor. In reality, they contain enzyme inhibitor. These enzyme inhibitors, they go inside the body of that insect, and inside their body, they stop a metabolic pathway. You know, in human body or in other living cell, there are several metabolic pathways regulated by different enzymes. So if you provide some enzyme inhibitors, definitely it will stop that metabolic pathway. As a result, the insect will die. So the example is cyanide. Cyanide will block cytochrome oxidase. Cytochrome oxidase is the part of ETC. ETC is what? ETC is electron transport chain. It is what? Electron transport chain. Electron transport chain. This electron transport chain provides us a lot of ATPs. You know, this is the place where NADH comes, and the energy of the NADH is converted into ATPs. So blocking the electron transport chain will result in stoppage of the ATP formation. As a result, this cell will die. Second, last one, sixth one is the fluoride. Fluoride block enolase oxidase. Enolase enzyme. Well, less for this is not oxidase, sorry. Enolase enzyme. And enolase enzyme is present in glycolysis. You know, glycolysis is the part of glucose metabolism. So fluoride will inhibit this enolase enzyme. As a result, glycolysis will not take place. So these two inhibit what? Metabolism of the organism. Others will stop the metabolism of the bacterial cell wall. And here it will stop the metabolism of the alcohol. In every step we saw that one enzyme is being blocked by the inhibitor. So this topic was very much important, very interesting from your examination point of view as well as from the clinical point of view. You can write a lot of things about irreversible inhibition in your exam. And while going to the MBBS side or Pharm-D side, it will be useful for you. So this was the topic of today. I hope you got one thing I just remember here, that in this world, the reality of this life, the reality of this world is that we saw a person, a scientist is discovering something. He or she is working hard to discover something. In the reality of life is that at one side of the world, a person is discovering this toxic compound that is taking the life of other person. That is taking the life of other person. This is one discovery. And on the other side, we have another discovery that it is giving life to a person. So here the discovery is saving the life of a person. Here the discovery is taking the life of a person. So this is the reality of the life. A human can do anything. He or she can discover something bad, or he or she can discover something very good for the welfare of other humankind. So it is in the hand of them, whether they use their hand in a bad way, whether they use their brain in a bad way or in a good way. So this is the reality of life. We should learn this. Okay, take care. Thank you and bye-bye.